servants of the Lord, praise the name of the Lord from this time forth and evermore, from the rising of the sun to its going down. The Lord's name is to be praised. Let's open with a word of prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, our hearts are open to you. Our desires are known to you. Before you, there are no secrets. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. And all God's people said, amen. If you would now please stand, have our call to worship, and then open with some song. Now, this morning's call to worship comes from Psalm 95. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms. For the Lord is the great God and the great King above all gods. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand.
I will follow
all of your ways,
all your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You
may be seated. Well, obviously we have a lot of folks traveling today or busy with stuff, which is kind of normal. So we will remember, you know, a prayer time to keep everyone in prayer for whatever they have going on today, whether they be traveling or just have family obligations. Just a couple of announcements today. Obviously, the bulletin is incorrect. We don't have Sunday school today because it is after 11 and we're not there. So no Sunday school today. We will be eating right after service. So, folks didn't want to come. That's more food for us. So along those lines, if anybody feels led to work the grill this morning and wants to run out there as soon as I'm done, the burgers and dogs are downstairs. Dogs are in the fridge. Burgers are in the freezer. So they are, you know, prepackaged patties, and you got to cook them from frozen or they become a mess. So we'll get food going as soon as we can after service this morning. Couple of other announcements. I have somewhere here. Oh, tomorrow. We are going to be planting flowers on all the veterans' graves, as we do every year. We're going to start at 9 a.m. So many hands make light work. Usually it's about an hour, hour and a half, and we're done with that. So if you have time, please come on out. It's supposed to be nice, sunny, maybe a little bit warmer than right now, so it should be a good day. Also, last week we made an announcement that, you know, the deacons were meeting with the person who we have found, who God sent us to act as our mediator. And really going forward, I'm not going to refer to him as a mediator anymore, because he doesn't like that term, and I kind of agree with him. He likes to think of himself as a coach in transition, helping churches who are going through periods of transition. And that's what he does. So we are moving forward, and we will be having a congregational meeting to really dive into a whole bunch of things, and that's probably going to be mid-late June. So keep your ears open. A lot of it just depends on scheduling, you know. But in the coming weeks, we'll have more to announce on that. Also this morning, I have some information up here on the chair. If you want to grab it later, the Reese's came out with a new informational pamphlet, a little nice little trifold thing that kind of goes into what's going on with them now. We all know that, you know, their assignment has changed over the years from Haiti to Dominican Republic, but a lot of great things going on with them. They are making a lot of strides in their meeting their goals. So this is here. Feel free to take one, take two, take three if you have friends that you might want to hand these out to. Also, you know, in the past I had mentioned that there was going to be a giving match through International Ministries in the month of June. I also have a little handout with information on that also, because if you are already giving to them, you can't just increase what you're giving through our normal channels, or they don't get credit for it. So there's information on here on how to go about that. And remember, even if it's only $10 a month, you know, that's $120 a year. That will be doubled. So they would get an extra $120 for this year. Every little bit helps. They're that close to reaching their goal. So if you can give anything, please prayerfully consider that. If you need any help with that, please see me, and I'd be glad to walk you through that. Are there any other announcements? All right, before we move on to our hymn, I want to take a moment just to focus a little bit on Memorial Day. You know, this is Memorial Day weekend, and obviously, you know, things have changed over the years. We as a church don't quite have the people that we used to have, the numbers to really do a lot of what we used to do, but it still is an important time, especially for us as Americans. So I have just a little bit to share on Memorial Day, and then we will have a little bit of a moment of silence and a prayer afterward, okay? Memorial Day, originally called Decoration Day, was instituted to honor Union soldiers who died in the Civil War after World War I. The purpose of the day was expanded to include all men and women who died in U.S. military service. Today, Memorial Day is often thought of as the unofficial start of summer, a long weekend with a car race, if you're a NASCAR fan, and you should be, playoff basketball maybe, brats and burgers on the grill. And one thing that this author wrote this, which I like, he says, it's always tricky to know how Christians should or shouldn't celebrate patriotic holidays. Certainly, he said, some churches blend church and state in such a way that the kingdom of God morphs into a doctrinally thin, nebulous civil religion. But even with this danger, there are a number of good reasons why Christians should give thanks for Memorial Day. And here's five. One, being a soldier is not a sub-Christian activity. Many men and women who are believers are called to serve their country. Two, the life of a soldier can demonstrate the highest of Christian virtues. Soldiers in battle are called to show courage, daring, service, shrewdness, endurance, hard work, faith, obedience. These virtues fall into the quote-unquote whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just category that we read about in Philippians. Three, military service is one of the most common metaphors in the New Testament to describe the Christian life. We are to fight the good fight. We're called to put on the armor of God, to serve as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. When we remember the sacrifice, single-minded dedication, and discipline involved in the life of a soldier, we are calling to mind what we are supposed to be like as Christians in service to Jesus. Four, love of country can be a good thing. As Christians, we have dual citizenship. Our first and ultimate allegiance is always to Jesus, whose heavenly dwelling will be our eternal home. But we're also citizens of this earthly country. We will stand before God not as individuals wiped clean of all earthly nationality, but as people with distinct languages, cultural affinities, and homelands. It is not wrong to love our distinct language, our culture, or our nationality. Love of God does not mean we love nothing else on earth, but rather we learn to love these things on earth in the right way, with the right proportions and right priorities. Love of country is a good thing, and it is right to honor those who defend the principles that make our country good. Number five, and this is one that's under attack today. I believe the facts of history will demonstrate that on the whole, the United States military has been a force for good in the world. Now, obviously, there are times when they act immorally. But on the whole, the men and women of our armed forces have fought and are fighting for causes that promote freedom, defend the rights of human beings, and reject tyranny. War is still hell, and it's an unfortunate, tragic result of the fall. But praise God for his promise to one day end all human conflict. In a world where people are evil by nature and leaders are not always reasonable and countries do not have good intentions, war is sometimes the way to peace, and at least the best peace that we can hope for between peoples and nations on this side of heaven. So, thank God that we have a day to remember God's common grace to America and his special grace in enlisting us poor weak soldiers that we are in service to Jesus, our captain and conquering king. Now, if you would, I want to have just a brief moment of silence as we think of, pray for all those who have given their life in service to this country. Then I will lead us in a short prayer, and then we will stand to sing our first hymn. Just a moment of silence. Dear Heavenly Father, this time of the year, every year, is a good opportunity for us to pause and remember all of the good virtues that come with being an American. You have blessed this nation, a nation that was, regardless of what some want to think, founded on principles of your word, a nation that respects the innate right of the individual, a nation that historically has always stood for freedom, especially the freedom to worship you. It is a great honor to have been born in this nation. It is a great honor to be part of a nation that historically has always been a safe haven for people all over the world who are persecuted, looking for a place to find home, find peace. I believe we still are that today. In that light, I thank you, Lord. We thank you for the many men and women who have given their lives in defense of this great nation. It's a very sobering thought. And it reminds us, one, just how important and how dear and how valuable life truly is. So we thank you for those that have given their life on our behalf, in part so that we might gather here today, free of persecution, free of government oversight, free to worship you as you've called us to do. I pray that we would continue to do so. And Lord, this weekend, especially tomorrow, as many cities all over this country gather to remember those who have fallen in service to this country, we pray that we would have the best of intentions, that we would truly lift up those who are to be remembered, who are to be honored, and that we would do so while acknowledging all this comes as part of your grace to us. We ask you to bless this time and bless the families of those who mourn today. We ask all this in your Son's name. Amen. And if you would then please stand and take turn in your blue hymnal to hymn number 403 as we sing Blessed Assurance.
Looking up, filled with his good.
Thank you. You may be seated. Prayer concerns this morning. How many would have an unspoken request? Others. Luke.
Bill Humphrey and his wife have COVID, and this is of a great concern to me.
Yes. A friend of mine's wife also came down with COVID the other day, and she's not doing too great today. Her name is Tina Crossan, so keep her in prayer. Any others?
My friend Ron is still in the hospital. Well, actually, he's not in the hospital. He's in a rehab center. He's off the vent. He has a trachea just to keep him from taking stuff into his lungs that isn't supposed to be there. He's having vision problems, swallowing problems, walking issues. I think that's it.
That's enough, right?
That's enough.
Yeah. Ready.
It's a special person's camp,
okay.
And we just ask that you keep a very, very thin staff, and the volunteers and all the folks that make these programs happen, in your thoughts and prayers as we go through the summer.
Also, you know, keep our nation in prayer. It seems like every couple of days there's a new issue, right? Along those lines, you know, also pray for, you know, the Middle East. You know, this ongoing skirmish between Hamas and Israel, and the fact that the vast majority of the world just doesn't care, or would rather see Israel just wiped out. I do pray that, you know, our leadership of this country would stand up in support of them, but so far that hasn't really happened. So keep that the whole situation in prayer, along with, you know, camp starting. I mean, summer's here, folks, so I think we want to keep everybody in prayer, right? Because this summer, you know, things are going to sort of get back to a normalcy. What's that going to look like for a lot of people? I don't know. You've got a lot of businesses that are still just struggling to staff. I mean, that's all over the place. Across the board, all industries, food service to manufacturing to, I mean, everything. And so, you know, we really need to keep in prayer a lot of the business owners. And I think more than ever, this is a great time to shop local, support local, especially, you know, we've got so many small businesses, even in our own community, that they need to recoup a lot of what has happened over the last year. I think also, you know, we continue to keep in prayer all those people who really we've made, for lack of a better term, freeloaders over the last year and a half. You know, part of the reason we've got such an unemployment problem is because we just keep giving money out for nothing. And, you know, there is a point where I think you call into question people's integrity. You know, what they stand for is people. How can you continue just to sit at home and collect money you haven't earned when you're called to lead and raise and support your family? You know, that's something I think that we just need a return to integrity, a return to, you know, good old-fashioned work ethic, really just a lot of biblical principles that are lost on us today. And, you know, it's not just in the workforce, but it's across the board. So in that, you know, I think we continue to pray for revival in this nation, but understanding that revival always starts with us. You know, revival starts with us, and that's the hard thing. So as we go into the summer, I want to ask everybody, you know, stop and really make a commitment to prayer. If we're going to see revival in our cities, in our nation, in our church, it starts with us, and it starts with a commitment to seek God in prayer. It has to, that always has to precede everything. And we'll talk more about that later, you know, especially as we go through this sermon series. But, you know, I think it's hugely important. Any other prayer concerns? All right, if not, let's turn to the Lord in prayer then. Dear Heavenly Father, as always, it is a joy to come before you this morning. It is a joy to be known by you. It is a joy to be called out of the world into your kingdom, to be gathered here at this church with the fellow believers. Pray that you would continue to use us, that you would continue to shape us and mold us as you grow us in holiness, as you grow us in love for one another, as you grow us in patience. Pray that we would continue to look for new ways and new opportunities to serve others in your name. As it is a joy to gather, it is also a joy to lift up our concerns and our needs before you. We think of all those who are struggling with COVID right now, but we specifically this morning lift up Bill and his wife, and Tina, and in all these cases, just pray that you would touch them and heal them, and that their illness would you know, subside quickly, that they wouldn't have any long-term effects. We think of Ron and are thankful for the progress he's making, and pray that you would continue to heal him and give him strength of mind and body, that he would be able to get off the trach and be able to hopefully address some of the other issues that he is dealing with. One of the joys and one of the great ministries that this church takes part in is the camp, and as summer is here, we ask you to bless the camp. We ask you to bless all those who are going to be working. And especially bless all the many young people that are going to be there this summer. We pray that it truly would be a time of growing closer to you. We pray that you would awaken hearts and minds, that you would convict these young people of their sin and ask them to turn their hearts to you as the only source of salvation. And we pray that as that happens, you would be with the counselors, you would be with the camp directors, and that you would just give them wisdom and patience and understanding, that they would know how to handle each and every situation that might come before them. As we prayed earlier, it is a great blessing to be part of this country that we all are, to be born in America. And, you know, we ask that you would truly be with the leaders of this nation, that they truly would be godly in their actions, that they would be people of respectable, I guess really dignity, people of dignity, that America would be looked at as a shining light to the rest of the world. We also think of the ongoing conflict in the Middle East, and we pray that it would come to an end. We pray that that more countries would come to Israel's defense. We lift them up before you, and above all, pray that they would seek you during this time. But we also ask that this current conflict would come to an end quickly, and that there wouldn't be any life lost. Lord, as we open your word, I pray that you would make us aware, that you would open our minds, open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, that we would have understanding of how it is that you moved through the early church, how it is that you grew those people, used them, and really how the early church just exploded. We pray that we would seek to have the same mind as they did, and that you would use us much in the same way. As we open your word, I pray that you would bless our reading of it, that it would shape us, mold us, and grow us into the image of your son, Jesus. We ask all this in his name. Amen. Okay, so we continue our sermon series through the book of Acts. Today we will be in the end of chapter 2, verses 40 through 47. In the last couple weeks, you know, we've talked a lot about the gospel and about the fact that Peter preached this magnificent sermon, and then last week we focused on repentance because people are called to repent and then place their faith, trust in Christ. And again, you know, last week we asked the question, now what, right? You've heard the gospel, now what? So you could almost ask the same question, okay? So now you're a Christian, now what? What the heck are you supposed to do next? What does it look like to be a Christian? How does God grow new believers into mature disciples? These are two important questions that every church should ask, but two questions that we'll be looking at today. For many of us, if you can think about it, if you can believe it, probably not at this moment, but there was a time when all of us were probably on fire for Jesus. A time when you just felt alive. When the gospel was fresh and sweet to your soul. You can remember having a passion for him, wanting to grow in your knowledge of the Bible and your service to others. And then we joined a church. And what we found was that the place we believed would be a conduit for maturity and growth, in a lot of ways, turned out to be the opposite. We energetically volunteered to serve on boards, work with kids, maybe teach Sunday school classes. But over time, we found ourselves becoming busier and busier, but not really growing in the way that we had hoped. Rather than growing in holiness, we found ourselves growing in frustration. The hurrier we got, the less we seemed to get done, right? And you probably had moments where you're on your knees before God and you're saying, this can't be all that Christianity is meant to be. There has to be more. For those of us who found the courage to express our frustration, we were often told that this was just a sign that we needed to do more. We were told that this was normal and we should just push through and persevere. But over time, many become jaded and in some cases pull away from participation in the church altogether. It's not that we were mad at Jesus. No, we still love Jesus very much. But our frustration with the church boiled over, and for many people, it became better to stay home than to intentionally put ourselves in a situation that would lead to more stress, more frustration, and disappointment. And yet we can't shake this voice in our head that keeps saying, but there has to be more. This can't be what it's supposed to be. I think of an interview years ago that was given by, if you guys remember the comedian Sam Kinison, late 80s, early 90s, you know, not friendly for children, right, Sam Kinison. Well, Sam Kinison's brother was a very devout Christian. And in an interview, the interviewer asked his brother if he was disappointed that he wouldn't see Sam in heaven. And Sam's brother said, oh no, I'll see Sam in heaven. And the interviewer kind of pulled his head back. He says, you misunderstand. He said, Sam wasn't mad at Jesus. Sam was mad at the church. And a lot of what you saw was a result of Sam's frustration and anger with the church. And I think we can identify in a lot of ways. But in any case, we still are left the question that there has to be more. Let's turn, if we would, then to the scriptures. Acts 2, starting at verse 40. Now, if you remember, this is after Peter preaches his magnificent sermon, tells the crowd that they are to repent, be baptized. And we pick it up in verse 40. He says, and with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly. Some of your translations will say they were devoted to the apostles' doctrine, fellowship, and the breaking of bread, and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods, and divided them up among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Now, we hear that, and we get certain images in our head, right? Some of them are confusing because we ask ourselves, what the heck does this actually look like? You've got a very small area. You've got 3,000 people added to the church in one day, and in the days, weeks, months afterward, we get this picture of this communal living. And often, unfortunately, the thing that we focus on when we hear that passage is verses 44 and 45. Right? We focus on the fact that all these who believe were together, had all things in common, sold their possessions, and there was no need. And that's the thing that we hear. And we say, ah, that's what the church needs to be about. That's what the church should be doing in the world today. And they're not necessarily wrong. They've missed the focus. Some of what drives that actually within the church is a little bit of greed and covetousness. Because we see people that have things that we don't, and we say, well, they had all things in common. Therefore, you shouldn't have more than I should. But the reality is what the situation is there, we're talking about people in basic needs. You know, we've been blessed to live in a country where even the poorest of our people have their basic needs met, and they're rich by comparison to most of the world. So a lot of what we read here isn't our experience. Because we really don't know a lot of people who truly, truly are destitute. So that kind of clouds our image of what's really going on here. But the more important thing is the fact that this activity of the early church isn't possible without what came beforehand. When we focus on the way the early church acted and grew, we're missing the boat if all we do is focus on this helping each other. Because something led to that. And the thing that led to that are the things that God uses to grow you and I into the image of Jesus. I've titled this message, God's Means of Grace. So what do I mean by that? Question is, what are the things that God has given us that when we employ them, when we partake in them, will lead to our growth in knowledge, holiness, and love for one another? If you had to answer that question, if you had an answer to that question, if you had an answer to the question of what would lead to these things, and you could be sure that it would work, would you commit to partaking in them? We're talking about growing in knowledge, holiness, love for one another. If you had an answer to those, and you could be certain that that answer would work in your life, how committed would you be to practicing those? In other areas of life, I think we'd be very committed, right? If you had a question of, how do I get myself in shape and just look awesome? How do I get that beach bod that I've always wanted and never been able to have? How can I get it, know it's going to work, and I can maintain it? Well, if I knew for certainty that I could have it, I might be more committed to doing the things to get it, right? It's also true with our own life. In this passage, we see four things. One, doctrine, God's word. Two, fellowship. Three, the breaking of bread, communion, and 4, prayers. These all come from verse 42. And these are the things that those early disciples were doing. And it doesn't just say they were doing it. They were steadfast in it, devoted to it. In the past, I've talked about the 4 P's of Christian ministry, and unsurprisingly, they're very similar. The 4 P's being proclamation of the word, prayerful dependence on the Holy Spirit, people as God's fellow workers, and patient perseverance. Well, those are really just a reformulation of these means of grace that we're talking about today. So back to the means of grace then. Generally, when we use that phrase, it's used to describe the means by which God uses to grow his church and his people. Now, some of you might hear that and ask the question, how are these means of grace any different than what the Catholic Church refers to as the sacraments? Well, I'm glad you asked. In Catholic theology, in sacramental theology, the means of grace is a manner or instruments by which God imparts grace to the recipient. The sacrament becomes a container of grace. And when you partake in it, you're literally receiving grace from God, which is why you have to do them if you want to be saved. Because it's the only way that you're going to get grace. One of the downfalls of that system is that the sacraments get elevated to a primary position and God's word gets pushed down. God's word is not a source of grace in the same way that the sacraments are. Now, for our benefit and for the joy of the church, during the Protestant Reformation, there was a recovery of God's word as the primary focus, the primary thing which gives us God's grace. The Reformers saw the error and corruption that existed as a result of the Catholic view on this, and through study of the scriptures, they reduced the sacraments from 7 in the Catholic system to really 2, baptism and the Lord's Supper. And then all of us that came in the Baptistic tradition started referring to them as ordinances rather than sacraments. So today, you know, even in our statement of faith, you'll read about these ordinances, baptism and the Lord's Supper. And this primarily comes from the Reformation focus on sola scriptura, which is scripture alone, as our main source of doctrine, of life. Grace is communicated through the Word of God, but is confirmed by the sacraments, or what we would call the ordinances. Theologian Herman Bovink had this to say. Now, when he says sacraments, think ordinances, right? They are visible, holy signs and seals instructed by God so he might make believers understand more clearly and reassure them of the promises and benefits of the covenant of grace, and believers on their part might confess and confirm their faith and love before God, angels, and humankind. One thing that we tend to get wrong is we tend to think that we're doing those things for God. So many people will go to get baptized and they'll say, well, it's something I want to do for God. Well, it's not exactly what's going on there. We do something, but really we're passive. Someone baptizes us. It is a sign and seal of God's grace in our life, but it also communicates to everyone else involved, you know, what has happened, the declaration that you are no longer walking in the kingdom of darkness, but you're now walking in the kingdom of the Son. But back to the scripture, you know, what we see, the very first means of grace that we come across in Acts 2:42, is it's described there as the apostles' doctrine, but really it's scripture, God's word. In speaking of God's word, Bovink puts this, has this to say too. He says the first and most important means of grace is the Word of God. For the Word of God, both as law and gospel, is the revelation of the will of God. People ask all the time, right, what's God's will for my life? What's found in the Scriptures? It's found in His holy law that gives us instruction on how to live. And we see this throughout the New Testament. Romans 1:16, the gospel is the power of God for salvation. Where do we find that gospel? In the Holy Word. 1 Corinthians 1:24, the preaching of Christ is power of God and wisdom of God. James 1:18, God calls us to be brought forth, how? By the word of truth. Then 1 Peter, you have been born anew, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. So what happens if we do not see the word of God as central in the life of the church? What things can creep in and replace it? Well, when we depart, when we don't see the Word of God as central, we end up looking at other things for our growth. And we can replace it very easily with busyness, with activities. Fellowship is the second means of grace. Now, as I go through this, I'm going to be moving kind of quickly, right? We could spend a whole series talking about each one of these things. But as we go through the book of Acts, they'll unfold a little bit more, and we'll have time to really delve in more as we journey through the book of Acts. Fellowship. Now, we all lift up and we all acknowledge that fellowship is important to the life of the church. But part of the problem we run into is that the New Testament doesn't give us a clear definition of what the heck fellowship is, does it? It's assumed. We get examples of it. But there's no real clear description of how you're supposed to engage in fellowship with one another as believers. But one thing is crystal clear. One thing that's required to have fellowship is community. Community of believers. The word we see in the New Testament quite often that's translated to fellowship is koinonia. And one of the things that is vitally important is that koinonia is not just an activity. Koinonia is a relationship. It's a community relationship. So, we have a community, and one of the questions we have to ask is what unites this community? And this is where we tend to get it wrong. We tend to see our union as the church. The church, its activities, and its programs, these are the things that unite us together. The reality is it's not unity in common goals or purposes that make a Christian community. It's the common life that Christ creates in each one of us. That common life, that shared life that's only made possible by the blood of Jesus is what unites us. In that, when we apply that to community, what we find is that fellowship is not just associating with one another here at Newman. As Jerry Bridges said, he said, God did not call us into association with Christ, but into union with him, into an actual sharing of his all-powerful life. Too often, in church, we merely associate with one another because we're all members of the same church. But what we're called to do is actually experience new life together. Now, the third means of grace, the breaking of bread, we refer to it as communion. What actually is communion? Again, we could talk at length on this. But in communion, we remember the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. The elements, bread and wine, are symbols of his broken body and his shed blood. What do they do? Now, if we go back to talking about Catholic theology, in communion, you're actually receiving the body and blood of Jesus. Therefore, you're actually receiving grace as you take them in. Well, when we look at communion and we say, no, that's not actually what's going on there. The body, the bread and the wine don't actually transform into Jesus' broken body, into Jesus' blood. We do this in remembrance, as we read in the New Testament. But it's not strictly just a remembrance, again, something that we do for God. But in that activity, we find a means of God's grace for us. As a body of believers, when we partake in communion, it draws our focus to Jesus as the source of our life together. In eating the bread, in drinking the cup, we have to look heavenward. It causes us to take our eyes off ourselves, to look backward at what Christ has done for us, and then look forward to the day that he will return. In communion, we are also reminded of the fact that we are accepted by God solely on the basis of what Jesus has done. There is nothing that you can do that will make God accept you or love you any more than he already does today. And that's a hard thing for us to remember. How many people need to hear that? How many people just feel so unworthy and are trying so hard to earn God's love, and it's already there for them? That is, we are reminded of that as we partake of communion together. What we see in Scripture is that our good works, our best works, are nothing but filthy rags before God. And one of the interesting things, you know, we tend to think of the Bible as a G-rated book. It's not really. When the Bible talks about our good works being as filthy rags before God, what it's really saying is those rags are menstrual rags. Your good works are no better than menstrual rags, used tampons before God. It's a pretty graphic image, but it conveys the picture that our good works aren't going to get us anywhere with God. Only Christ and his shed blood can create, maintain, and carry the relationship that we have with his Father. The fourth means of grace, prayer. Now, aside from the Word of God, number one, prayer might be the biggest flaw in most of our lives. And it's probably the biggest reason we don't experience God's power in our lives. Author and pastor Daniel Henderson writes this. He says, in the midst of modern developments, what we see as greatest strengths of the American church have become her greatest weaknesses. Somewhere along the way, unintentionally and gradually, we moved our feet of faith away from desperate dependence on the resurrection of Christ, away from the Holy Spirit as our only source of power, and away from desperate times of prayer. And I think it's very true. Pastor Jim Cimbala, who's pastor of the Brooklyn Tabernacle, wrote this. He said, 30 minutes of spirit-aided intercessory prayer is more effective than all the new programs and stylistic changes we are constantly tinkering with. Human ingenuity can't be compared to God's power. And I'm guilty like everyone else. How often do we truly spend time with God in prayer when we're not just asking for things, but when we're truly seeking his face? So often we miss the boat. You know, we meet. Think about Sunday morning. We gather here in this room for an hour-ish, right, together every Sunday morning. How many hours throughout the week do we pray in preparation for today? Well, let's probably zero. Let's back it up. How many minutes do we pray in preparation for today? We've got it all backwards. We spend moments in prayer and hours doing. We need to flip that. hours in prayer, seeking God's face, seeking his will, seeking his blessing. I think that's hugely important for us as a church going forward. If we want to really know what God's will is for us, well, then we need to seek his face in prayer. Now, as we talk about these means of grace, quite often when these things are referred to throughout church history and in writings and in theology books and this and that, we call them the ordinary means of grace. Why would we call them ordinary? Well, the big reason they're ordinary is that they're available to everyone. There's nothing super special about them. You don't have to be an ordained minister to exercise these means of grace. They're for everyone. They're ordinary because all of God's people partake in them and grow by them. Question. Again, as we move forward as a church, as we seek God's will for us, how we ought to relate to one another, how we ought to relate to the community, where do you see these means of grace fitting in? Where do you see them in the life of this church? I pray that you'll see them not just as helpful ideas, but as things that we are totally dependent on. As we move through the book of Acts, pay special attention to how these things become evident in the rise and explosion of the early church. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we read what happened in the early church. We read the focus on these things, this focus on the doctrine of the apostles or teaching, on fellowship, on breaking of bread, on praying together. And we really ask, can it really be that easy? I think in so many ways we have made this Christian life here just far too complicated. Help us to rediscover the old ways that you use to grow your people. Help us to fall in love with the simple faith that you have handed us. You haven't asked much of us. These simple things that really, if we partake in them, if we exercise them, they're for our benefit. They will grow us. They will grow our faith, they will grow us as individuals, they will grow us as a church. Help us to see that. And in the process of this, I pray that our desire for you would grow, that we would hunger for more of you, and that we would seek you in your word, that we would seek you through prayer, and that would drive us into vibrant fellowship with one another. Lord, I ask all of this in your son's beautiful name. Amen. If you would then please turn in your red hymnal to hymn number 298 and stand as we sing, "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds."
Thank you.
good living